introduce Professor Shaun Gallagher, who is the Lillian and Laurie Moss Chair of Excellence in Philosophy at the University of Memphis. He's also a Humboldt Fellow and has secondary appointments at the University of Hertfordshire and the University of Wollongong, and many, many research associations with universities across the world. Shaun is most well known for his work in cognitive phenomenology and philosophy of mind, and he's also advanced the fields of embodiment and intersubjectivity. And we're very pleased to have him with us today. He's going to talk to us about philosophy of virtual environments. The sky is not the limit. Thanks, Shaun.
Thank you very much, and thank you, Shaun, for inviting me to Canada as well. So I wasn't quite sure what to talk about, but I was told that it should relate in some way to simulation. And so this is going to be about an experiment that myself and a team of researchers in Florida conducted, and we've come to the end of the experimental part of it. But we still have a lot of data that we are analyzing it, so we don't have the complete story, but I think I can give you enough of it to get a sense of what we're doing. And so a lot of this would be, I would say, fall under the heading of cognitive science, and at the very end, I'll try to raise some philosophical issues about what we've been trying to do and where we'd like to go with this. So this is a started when I heard a number of reports that were generated by astronauts who went in a space shuttle into the International Space Station, and they would come back and report on having certain kinds of experiences that might be best described as experiences of awe and wonder. Some of them experienced very deeply aesthetic feelings, others, spiritual types of experiences, and a few of them even describe religious experiences when they are up in space, traveling in space. So we have a good number of reports from the astronauts about this type of experience, describing it in some detail. And of course, from a philosophical and a scientific perspective, the question would be, well, what exactly are they experiencing? And then, of course, we have to figure out how are we going to answer that kind of question. So how do you study these kinds of things? In some sense, it's a study of consciousness. It's a certain kind of consciousness that they were experiencing. And short of going up into space, I suppose, and looking up some things up there, what are we going to do? So I think there are four questions that we can ask. At least four, maybe many more, to formulate a kind of scientific study or scientific approach to these kinds of experiences. First, can we characterize these experiences in their own terms as experiences? Second, can we replicate them in something like a lab setting? Third, can we then measure physiological, neurophysiological components or correlates of these experiences? And fourth, can we say something about how a person's background might play into the experiences? It turns out not all astronauts had the experience, but their backgrounds were quite various. So some of them were hard-nosed scientists and engineers, not expecting to have anything like a spiritual experience. Some of them are atheists. Some of them have religious backgrounds. So they come from all kinds of backgrounds. But we were all interested in how a cultural background or a religious background might also influence the kind of experiences that they might have. So in order to do what we think is actually the first scientific study of these types of experiences as they relate to space travel, we assembled an interdisciplinary team of researchers in Florida, and we conducted a study using a combination of methods that included methods from philosophy, which involve things like hermeneutics, phenomenology, I'll try to explain how that works, psychology, neuroscience, simulation science, and even art history. Here is the team of researchers that played the main role in this. Some of them work in what's called the Media Convergence Lab, so they're basically engineers who are expert in creating simulations. Others are, like Warren Reinerman there, is a psychologist, a neuropsychologist. Others, Bruce Johns, is a philosopher. We also have some collaboration with people at the Humboldt University in Berlin, at a project called the Impact Project, or the sort of image act, picture act, they sometimes say, who are primarily art historians and a few philosophers. They helped us out. And also, some of you might know Jonathan Cole, who's a neuroscientist here in the UK. And we also even have a NASA astronaut on our team as a consultant, Jeff Williams, who himself does not hold the record for time spent in space, but is number two, spent a huge amount of time in space, and also had some of these experiences. So he was able to help us out quite a bit. He is now in training to go up into space for more time. So we have an interdisciplinary, international, and extraterrestrial team here. And the four questions, to come back to them, basically meant we have to try to figure out how exactly we're going to work out a study like this. And here is why we needed all these different types of approaches. So characterizing the experiences in their own terms, really that's something that phenomenology can help us with. And the hermeneutics part really has to do with textual analysis of the reports that came from the astronauts. Simulation science, we're going to use that to build a simulated environment and then put people in that environment. What that's like, it's a little bit cheaper than sending them out into space. It's like putting them into an outer space environment. And of course, the neuroscience, we use EEG and FNIR to see what's going on in the brain. And psychology, we also, because we wanted, again, to find out what kind of background might come into this, psychologists provided some questionnaires that we had the participants fill out. Okay, so here's what we did. First, as in, I guess, the majority of scientific studies on behavior and cognition, we used undergraduates. That was a big limitation, I guess, our study. But they were the ones we could recruit easily on campus. So what we did was we had our subjects come and we hooked them up with EEG, FNIR, ECG, so to measure cardiac effects. We did two experiments. In the first experiment, we put them into a mixed environment, mixed, that is to say, real stuff plus virtual reality, in a certain way, mixed. We had 40 students participate in the first experiment. In the second experiment, we put them into, we kind of immersed them in a simulated environment that was totally visual. So the first one involved kind of structure that we had to build. The second one was purely virtual. And we had 7 people. So we had about 110 subjects altogether. After they went into the simulation and had some experiences, then we conducted a special type of interview known as a phenomenological interview to see if we could get them to tell us about their experiences. And then we followed that up with a whole battery of questionnaires to see lots of different things about their cognitive, psychological, but also cultural background. So before we could do any of that, however, we had to start with a hermeneutical analysis. And here we basically were starting with what the astronauts gave us. Astronauts, cosmonauts, people who went into space. We found accounts from 45 different astronauts or cosmonauts. These were in-space journals that they kept and recording their experiences. And also, after they returned to Earth, some post-flight reflections and memories that they gave us in interviews and so forth. We then took the texts and we had two people sit down with them, working independently in order to identify a total of 48 different categories of experience that we found expressed in the text. We then took those and used about 20 other people, grad students and undergrads, to verify that these categories were there. And we were able to verify that 34 of these categories were agreed upon by the majority of people looking at the texts. So these are categories of experiences derived directly from the astronauts' descriptions. And these were the things we wanted to replicate, if possible. Here are some examples. Gus Grissom, an astronaut, a United States astronaut, says, there's a clarity, a brilliance to space that simply doesn't exist on Earth. And nowhere else can you realize so fully the majesty of our Earth and be so awed at the thought that it's only one of untold thousands of planets. Greg Chemetov from Canada. From these windows, the Earth is so obviously floating in an endless void. And the feeling that washes over you is the sense of scale of the universe. The feeling I got was one of recognition that we are living on such a tiny island in a vast ocean. Another Canadian astronaut. One thing is just the sheer wonder of looking down on the Earth. It is very, very beautiful, particularly when you see it interface on the edge with space. There, you suddenly get the feeling that, hey, this is just one small planet which is lost in the middle of space. A very important feeling about the fact that we're just drifting through an immense universe. You become a little more conscious about the fact that we shouldn't be doing silly things on Earth like fighting and killing each other. And a Russian cosmonaut says, the atmosphere is very small, very thin, compared to the universe that surrounds the Earth. It made me feel that the Earth was very fragile and unprotected, and it worried me. It worried me. So there were a lot more texts. We had a lot more texts to look at, and we were generally looking for experiences that expressed awe and wonder. And we defined these things in the following way. We thought of awe as a direct and initial experience of feeling when faced with something amazing or incomprehensible or sublime. Wonder, we thought, was a more reflective experience, motivated when one is unable to put things into a familiar conceptual framework, leading to open questions rather than conclusions. Now, people might disagree about these, but these were the sort of terms we were operating with, definitions we were operating with in the study. And they guided our reading of the text that we were looking at. What we found was a whole mix of different things that seemed to relate to these two categories. Some things that were purely intellectual, some of the astronauts were just intellectual about it all. Others were much more aesthetic. Some seem to express spiritual experiences. Others seem to turn it into moral messages. And some, as I said, even have religious experiences. So here are some of the 34 categories that we were working with. Here are some categories that fell under the heading awe. So the idea of being captured by the view or drawn to the phenomenon. They were attracted. So most of the astronauts, in almost all circumstances, they were looking out windows of either the International Space Station or the Space Shuttle, looking at the Earth from close orbit or looking out into deep space. So it was always at these moments when they were looking out the window and seeing what they could see that they were having these types of experiences. So some of them started and then they didn't want to pull back. They didn't want to leave the window, and they were drawn, they were really attracted to what they were seeing. Some of them experienced a kind of elation. Some were what we call experience hungry. They wanted more and more of this particular experience. Some had experiences of being overwhelmed by what they saw. Others were surprised. And a lot of them expressed what we call scale effects, feelings of the vastness of the universe, or one's own smallness or insignificance. And in terms of wonder, these are some of the categories we found. They felt inspired by what they saw. They felt a kind of nostalgia. Some of them experienced what they call a perspectival, what we call a perspectival shift, a kind of internal change of attitude specifically tied to certain moral ideas that they were having. Some of them expressed a kind of sense that they were united to the whole universe, a feeling of oneness with the universe. Some of them just thought the universe itself was so well organized. There was a kind of unity to it, a oneness of everything. And some of them mentioned something like solidarity with all the people on Earth. And also, along with that, the idea that they have a kind of responsibility towards Earth or towards the people on Earth. So, taking these categories then, we use these as tools in order to sort out whether or not we were going to be able to replicate these actual experiences. What we did was, for the first experiment, we built what we call a virtual space lab. There were certain limitations that were limitations also in the second experiment, so I'll mention that. The whole issue of weightlessness, we were not able to replicate weightlessness. Right? There are ways you can try to do that or approach that, but then you wouldn't be able to do the kind of experiments we wanted to do, so we couldn't have that. But looking at the accounts from the astronauts, it seemed like weightlessness was not necessarily connected in any explicit way with the visual experiences they were having. Explicit way in the sense that they talked a lot about weightlessness the first couple days they were up in space, but after about 3 days, discussion of that just falls off. And then the visual experiences that they were having were much later than that. Of course, there can be, definitely there can be cross-modal connections between vision and vestibular proprioceptive changes that come along with weightlessness. So we don't want to rule that out, but there was no way for us to be able to deal with that. Also, I mean, the limitations are we're indoors, we're on Earth, we're not moving, you know, around in orbit or anything like that. We had our subjects seated in a kind of workstation, very similar to the workstation that was on the International Space Station. And then there were all kinds of practical limits about building this thing in the lab and so forth. This is a picture of the ISS workstation that we used as a kind of model. And here is the type of thing we wanted to build, and we did build. And it basically was a structure, a room, with that when you walk into it, it looks sort of like the in the interior of the space station type of place, surrounded by speakers. So in the first experiment, we actually had a launch sequence that was simulated primarily by sound. It was quite convincing when people talked about that. I'm not going to talk very much about the first experiment. It's really the second experiment that I think is the most interesting. We also had to select images. This is where the people at Humboldt University came in, and the art historians. We're able to do some research using the NASA image database and come up with certain recommendations about what kinds of images we should be using and certain criteria that we had to meet. This was a challenge also in terms of finding images that were appropriate to use as the basis for the simulation. So high quality images that would appear to be as real as they could on very large-scale monitors had to have a certain quality to them. They had to be also made dynamic in order to simulate what we needed to simulate. So luckily, NASA published a very recent image, which they called the Blue Marble 2012, in January 2012. And we used that as the basis for what we're doing. Here, I'm just going to skip. This is a video of computer process used to give us the image that we ultimately ended with. And this is the image that we use primarily for the Earth view. So let me go back and do that once again. What you have to imagine is this kind of moving away from Earth. Took about 7 minutes. It's very slow compared to several seconds here. But primarily, this is what most of the people were looking at in the experiment. And you'll see some details of that. So what we ended up with is something that looked on this order for the first experiment. This is the inside of the virtual space lab. At a kind of workstation. There are two portholes, and we opened them in sequence. One side showing deep space, the other side is showing close to Earth, around the Earth. So, the first experiments, we hooked people up to, and this is pretty much the same in both experiments. So, subjects were hooked up to the EEG and the FNIR and the ECG, and then exposed to the simulation. The EEG, we used a very simple one of 9 channels, measuring alpha, beta, and theta waves, giving us some indication of focused attention, mental effort, stimulus processing during the simulation. The FNIR, functional near infrared spectrography, gives us some indication of activation in the frontal and temporal areas. And of course, the electrocardiogram giving us some sense of heartbeat, and variability in that. The first experiment for each subject took about 2.5 hours going through the whole thing. Again, I'm not going to go into the details of that. The phenomenological interview was the same in both experiments, so let me say a few things about that. So this is based on an interview method developed by Francisco Varela's group in Paris. Back in the late 90s. Claire Petit-Vigan has published an account of this technique of phenomenological interview. And the primary aspects of it involve the idea of open questions, meaning that we didn't ask the subjects, did you experience awe or wonder? We just allowed them to tell us about their experiences in the simulation. So we simply invited them tell us what they experienced, what their feelings were like. A lot of times, they didn't have a lot to say, so then we had to use a technique of probing a bit. The interviewers were carefully trained not to introduce biases into anything. They didn't actually know what the categories were that they were trying to get to. But they were able to encourage and motivate more developed descriptions as they went along. And of course, focus on the experience of the subjects, not on their theories or opinions about what was what in the simulation. Although we had some people criticizing our simulations as not as good as they could be. But a lot of them were used to going to Disney World. This was in Orlando. And Disney has some very good simulations, and we weren't quite up to their level. And then part of the technique is to say back to the participant what they just said. So they might give us a description of something, and then we respond by repeating that, which then invites them in a certain way to expand, to fill in details, or to correct what we have. So there are specific techniques involved in the phenomenological interview to try to avoid bias and to try to get to as much detail about first-person experience as possible. The questionnaires then that followed involved measurements of The first one especially is interesting measurements of religiosity, spirituality, personality, and cognitive type measures to try to get a sense of the differences that we might find among the different participants. So there was a whole battery of these things that we used afterwards. Okay, and then one challenge that we had was trying to correlate in real time the simulation timeline and all of the measurements we were taking. That turned out to be pretty easy with the objective measurements. So the EEG, the FMR, and the cardiogram, they are, we had software that would correlate all of that along the timeline of the simulation. So that was no problem. But in order to correlate the phenomenological interview with the simulation, because that wasn't going on in simulation time, this is afterwards, we have to pick out landmarks, so to speak, in the simulation, and then we have to be careful to try to get the participants to indicate when this experience occurred, I mean, during what, in the what was going on in the simulation as you were having this experience, and so forth. So it was really a kind of mapping that we had to do. But we were able then, by that, in that sense, to get the specific categories, such as perspectival shift or scale effects, to line up with specific instances of what's going on in the simulation, and then look them at to see what's going on with EEG and FMR and so forth. So the results from the first experiment was that not all participants had these experiences, but then again, not all astronauts had. But we were able to replicate some, but not all categories of experience in the first experiment. Here's an example of one of the participants and what they had to say. It's a view of Earth that you don't see regularly, and you don't really look at it from such a big point of view that everybody on the on that small little planet, and you're so far away now, I think it just really makes you feel less important when you look at everything in such a view like that. You're just a speck on the Earth that's in a universe of many different planets. Another says, I think it's the vastness of reality. To me, when I start thinking of how huge our universe is, like just looking at this, and this is just a little part of what I'm looking at, and how much more is there? How much more there is? That's the part that I admired, the beauty of the lights and all that, but to me, somebody created all that, and that blows me away. Or again, a little bit of Earth was in view at the bottom of the looking out the window, let's say, I was immediately much more drawn into that. It was enthralling. Well, it was exciting to look at the planet. And finally, I was taken aback in awe. I was definitely admiring, definitely peaceful, relaxed, and then just liking all of my mind taking me where I was really reflecting on how huge space is. So the most frequent experiences in that first experiment were these perspectival shifts in a certain moral sense of looking at the Earth. These are kind of thoughts about ecology, but also about war, and what people are doing on Earth, and so forth. A kind of intellectual interest or inquisitiveness, or curiosity, contentment, a feeling of relaxation, contentment. Sometimes significant sensory experiences such as silence or the descriptions of the visuals, and some of them felt inspired in a kind of reflective way. Compared to the frequency in astronauts, they kind of compare well, except for the scale effects, where 7 in the astronauts the reports there were 7 reports of that type of thing. But in the participants in the experiment, there were 22, so that seemed quite a jump. And we had 23,000 words of astronaut journals and so forth, and 37,000 participants to analyze from that first. And there were some preliminary and rough correlations with EEG and FNIR. I'm going to skip for this first, I'll go in more detail for the second. There is a paper that we published basically reviewing what we did in this first experiment and picking out all the problems we encountered, and then we used that first experiment basically to redesign things and to run the second experiment. So the second experiment simplified things. In the first experiment, we actually had a kind of narrative when we were, so to speak, suiting them up to go into the virtual space lab, putting on the FNIR and all this headgear, and we were kind of giving them a narrative about going to space travel and things like that. And then, of course, we put them in a physical environment that was very much like a spaceship. And there were so many things going on that in the end we were saying, well, how do we know for sure that it's the visuals that are giving us this experience, rather than the whole setting? So in the second experiment, we sort of cut all that other stuff out. It was no longer mixed reality. It was no longer a narrative involved. There was no launch sequence or anything like that. Rather, we just gave them the images, and we gave them in a kind of cave-like setting, so they were really immersed in these images. And also, we introduced a control condition. Control simulation for all the participants was a seven-minute simulation of colored geometrical figure moving away from them in the same way, the same timing as we'll see the Earth moving away in the real task. This was extremely boring for most people. But then we had a close Earth start moving away from Earth, as you saw in that image before. And we had two different starts. One was a very focused start, just in a sense hovering above the University of Central Florida campus where they all went to school. So they were very familiar. It has a kind of iconic shape to it. It's a kind of a round campus. And they all, in later interviews, they expressed familiarity with that. We called this the F group because it was focused. We also had a G group, which was much more global. So they started almost in darkness with one very slight amount of light coming on one side of the Earth. So they were starting up further. Both the F and the G group end up with the same scene of Earth at a distance at the very end. We also introduced a kind of self-report on experience after the interview, asking them, well, did you experience anything that you would describe as awe? And we gave them the definitions and so forth. That was just a simple Likert scale. So the top is the focused one, that's the canvas, and that's the starting, that's 6 seconds into it. 6 seconds into the global group, you're still kind of in darkness, and you have sort of the sun rising over here, and then it sort of opens up into much more light. In fact, it becomes kind of blinding light at the very beginning. And then after 6 minutes and 45 seconds, close to the end of the 7 minute period, this is what they're seeing. They're seeing very similar global images far from here. So we did a neurophysiological analysis from the EEG and FNIR over the 7 minutes. So we compared F group and G group across those 7 minutes, looking for differences in alpha, beta, theta, and we also the FNIR, the right and the left from the cortex. For theta frequency, we found no significant differences across the minutes versus across the F versus G condition, or even the participants who experienced one under versus non-experiencers. And this differs a little bit from the first experiment which we can talk about. But I think it has to do with the length. In the first experiment, they experienced 12 minutes, and then again another 12 minutes of the simulation. Here it's much shorter, and they could attend to it better. In alpha, however, we did find some interesting differences. So there were decreases in the left hemisphere alpha in both the F and the G groups during minutes 2 and 7, and greater decreases in the F group during minute 7. So alpha activity has been associated with a broad spectrum of conscious cortical activity, so there are numerous ways to explain the significance found along this bandwidth. Decreases in alpha may indicate higher non-task focus, that is, a more reflective focus, as you might expect to be found in something like wonder. The alpha levels in the F group may also, however, be explained in relationship to certain unpleasant visual movement that they experienced as they sort of made a transition from seeing the Earth up close through some clouds and then moving away from it. There was a kind of uncomfortableness to the simulation that many of them reported. And in the phenomenological interviews, they reported feeling dizzy around this time. So that also could be the reason alpha was changed. Changes in the alpha signal in the left hemisphere have been associated with lexical retrieval. So what we found, again, from the interviews, was that the participants, some of them were gamifying, so to speak, what they were doing. And specifically, they were looking and, in a sense, testing themselves, how many countries they could recognize. Some of them were looking for specific countries. So that could be kind of lexical retrieval involved in that, and that also could explain differences in alpha. So the big question is then, how should we interpret the change in alpha? This shows the importance of the phenomenological interview, since they give us some indications of what the experiences were like during the simulation. I think we get a better picture of the significance of the change in alpha when we compare those who experienced awe and wonder to those who did not. So, as I said, some people experienced some of these categories of awe and wonder and others did not. So, alpha in the left hemisphere, difference from baseline was above the mean for the non-experiencers and below the mean for the AW experiencers. So P14 and P44 were participants who had awe and wonder experiences. The baseline is zero. P65 and 64 did not have any of these awe and wonder experiences. The mean is there. So those who have, these are just two participants, but more generally, on average, those who have all wonder experiences have lower alpha signal, and those who did not have alpha signal similar to baseline. Of note, P65 here, a non-experiencer, was statistically even with the baseline. And then P44, who expressed during the interviews quite a bit of experiences along wonder, was consistently way below the mean. So A and W along wonder experiencers showed greater suppression of frontal alpha than along wonder non-experiencers. The experiencers were below the mean for frontal lobe difference from baseline, whereas the non-experiencers had higher frontal alpha. So alpha oscillations in the posterior regions follow a similar pattern with the A and W experiencers, or wonder experiencers, showing consistently lower alpha in the occipital parietal areas. All right, so there was some kind of consistency with respect to the alpha signal. For the experiencers versus the non-experiencers, the beta wavelength differences from baseline. We're not as ordered as alpha. So the experiencers and non-experiencers showing no significant difference or consistency across sides of the mean. But we did find differences in beta between the F group and the G group. So beta decreased globally in the F group. This is the focus group of people who started very close to the campus. But they increased for the G group during the first time segment. No difference during the middle time segment. And then both groups experienced decreases in left hemisphere beta activity in minute 7, although this was stronger in the F group. So increased beta changes have been implicated in suppression of motor activity. And we can make some sense of that, given that they were sitting pretty still, but also given what they were seeing. So the G group had significantly higher beta at both the beginning and the end of the simulation compared with the F group. The G group may have experienced a reduction of motor response due to fewer physical affordances in the stimulus compared to the F group at the beginning. The focus group, you know, was looking at the campus, basically, that they were very familiar with, and they could imagine themselves walking around. In fact, some of them expressed descriptions of where they were. They were actually looking for their girlfriend's apartment as they were kind of floating up into space and so forth. So if beta changes are indicators of motor suppression, this may suggest that broader context, the differences at the very start of the simulation, has some influence on subsequent motor possibilities, even as the simulation goes on. And FNIR measurements in the right frontal cortex showed significant differences, again, between the F and the G groups during that first minute. And that was expected due to significant differences in simulation in the images they were looking at. The F group, again, experienced a familiar image at the start. And during the images, the subjects said they recognized the campus images, and I said, looking for the girlfriend's apartment or the route that they take to go home. Differences in then executive function and frontal lobe activation would be expected, as opposed to the G group that was sort of just in darkness, nothing to grab onto, so to speak. And yet, this trend appeared throughout the simulation, again suggesting an enduring effect of the initial context. No significant differences in FNIR were found between the experiencers versus the non-experiencers of the long run. But this kind of contextual grounding, the notion that the starting point may have an enduring effect, is implicated in both the beta and the FNIR results. And that's associated with differences in brain areas involved in attention, memory, and relaxation. So in effect, the neuroscience provides a very complex picture that, of course, requires a lot more interpretation. However, while these findings begin to paint a picture of the neurological conditions associated with the experiences of looking at Earth from space, they alone are not sufficient for a full characterization of the experiences of all longer. So to explore the nature of such experiences, I think these findings have to be considered in their relationship to the self-reports, the phenomenological interviews that describe what the participants were experiencing. So here is, again, in the second experiment, one of the participants. It kind of makes me reflect how I look at other people around the world and what their struggles are and stuff like that. Looking at it from a different perspective, because with all of the land masses, everything looks like it's either connected or it's just a bunch of land masses with no borders. It's a little mind-blowing to see everything, just to see in that little space everything that's going on. And one more. Just the concept that we're on a big rock floating in the middle of nowhere. I mean, just the idea. That was like shocking. If you think about it like we're just here right now, but if you look from space, we're just floating. It's so big and massive and there's just nothing around it. It makes you wonder if we're here, we're inside Earth. What's Earth inside of it? What's that inside? It just multiplies and it's just really a complex thought. This might be a good way to start an intro to philosophy course. Lots of questions. I'll note that in the second experiment, we replicated all of the 34 categories that we picked out from the astronauts' descriptions. We did this little Likert scale, asking after the interview explicitly, did you experience all wonder given the definitions? And certainly for the far away distance, almost in all cases, they indicated yes. More for the G group, the near, where they started out in blackness and then had this kind of dramatic sunrise and things like that. They thought, yeah, they had awe and wonder. Amazingly, 15% here, 26% there, actually had these experiences when they were looking at the cube, the control, which was unexpected. But their wonder, despite the definition we gave them, they might just be they might have just been curious or wondering what the heck this is, and maybe that's confusing their reports. So participants who articulated experiences of awe and wonder in the phenomenological interviews were more likely to have reported awe and wonder on a Likert scale as well. So the data accordingly show a consistency across phenomenological interview, self-rating scales, and neurophysiology. I'll say one thing about the analysis of the questionnaires, focusing on this questionnaire about religiosity. The scores on this questionnaire are reversed, so higher positive scores mean lower levels of religious practice, for example. And there are subscales, two of them here, the experiential comforting faith, so items that reflect an experience of a close relationship with a higher power by asking for responses to such statements as, I feel God's presence, I desire to be closer, or in union with God. And the private religious practices, you know, how often do you meditate, how often do you read sacred texts, and so forth. And it turns out, a little paradoxical than we thought at first, for the people who experienced awe and wonder during the Earth condition, there were correlations with higher positive scores on the experiential comforting faith subscale and the private religious practices subscale. Higher scores, again, meaning lower religiosity. So participants who experienced awe in the Earth condition tended to have weaker perceived relation with a higher power and perform less religious spiritual behaviors. Why? So one possible answer comes from the model of awe and wonder developed by Keltner and Hay in 2003. And they said these experiences depend on perceived vastness and the inability to incorporate an experience into one's conceptual schema. They call it need for accommodation. So the idea is that perhaps those with higher religiosity could incorporate better space-related experiences into their conceptual schemes, which are already certainly spiritual or religious. Subjects who indicate that faith is comforting and who engage in religious practice may be better able to accommodate the effects of the visuals, or may have different expectations that modulate what they experience as awe and wonder. With respect to culture, in another aspect, there were a lot of expressions from the participants about certain expectations they had going into this. And they were in their constant mentioning films that they've seen, like Apollo 13, Space Odyssey, and Day After Tomorrow. And again, it was in Orlando, and they visited Disney, and they've encountered simulations of this sort. So here's a summary. The data analysis is still in process. We have a huge amount of data that we haven't gone through yet, and I've just given you bits of it here. I think that what we've done here, what we have here, is a good example of a neurophenomenological experiment that's being conducted with untrained subjects, in contrast to some other experiments that have been identified as neurophenomenological, where you have trained subjects. The trained interviewers, in a certain way, substitute for the phenomenological training that an artist can get. This use of phenomenological interview, I think, is an interesting idea in order to do something like this. We also used, of course, simulation to create the experimental environment, which we think actually provides flexibility, portability. If you want to have the simulation, let me know. I can send it to you on a computer. That's for the second experiment, anyway. We can build up or strip away contextual elements very easily. In the two experiments, we had two types of immersion. The first one was kind of immersion in a narrative and a physical setting. The second one was purely visual. And I think we confirmed with the second one that, you know, it is the visual that is giving the experience. One thing we discovered late in the game was that as we were analyzing all the interviews, the phenomenological interviews, using, again, the same categories that we derived from the astronauts' text, there were points where there was an expression of having difficulty finding the right words to say, you know, what they were experiencing. And we started to realize that, yeah, that kind of ineffability wasn't one of our categories. We were looking for categories, you know, specific positive things that they were experiencing. And we weren't really catching those kind of ineffable moments. So a little bit too late in the game, we started to say, yeah, there's probably something in there. And we would have to do some more analysis to talk about that. Finally, then, I want to conclude, if I have time, with a bit of philosophical reflection here. And one of the philosophical motivations behind this type of experiment, at least for me, was to think about what a non-reductivist cognitive science would be like. So implicit in the kind of approach we're taking in this study of Law and Wonder, and I think this generalizes to many other kinds of studies of consciousness, it's the idea that a full account will not be had simply by looking in the brain. Although obviously the neuroscience is an important component. So what we're trying to understand are aspects of experience that involve changes in the environment, very specific kinds of environment. Also, what kind of aspects of embodiment are involved? What aspects of culture and background processes come into play in these kinds of experiences? And the issue really is, can we develop experimental paradigms that can take all of these factors into account? So reductionistic science, which is usually the way it goes in cognitive science, oftentimes looks for complete explanation of cognition or consciousness in terms of relations between other more fundamental phenomena. So you have things like functionalism, where people might be satisfied with syntactical or representational explanations. You have people like Patricia Churchland who would say, no, you have to go lower. Neuronal explanations are what you're looking for. You have people like John Bickel who says all the action really is at the molecular level, and you really have to go down that far in order to get to work out the best explanation of something like consciousness. You have Penrose and, just recently, Chalmers talking about the collapse of the wave function at the quantum level as possibly interesting as a way to explain consciousness. So it looks like you can go all the way down to the basement level. And a lot of times you find claims that say something like, well, this is how science works. You know, if we want to explain a phenomenon, we have to go to the lowest components of it. So water, you know, what is that? The explanation of water is in terms of its molecular structure. All right. Or as Churchman in her most recent book puts it, we understand a macro level thing in terms of micro level parts and their organization. And again, that's what science is. If you want a scientific explanation, that's the way to go. But it seems that I would say that science needs to explain more than simply water is the same as H2O, it's a molecular structure, right? Because water, of course, has biological significance for organisms. Water is involved in other kinds of phenomena, like floods and droughts, hydraulics, oceanography, right? There's a lot of stuff that you can say about water that goes well beyond its molecular structure. And you seem to need more sciences than just chemistry or physics to be able to give a full account of all of this. So one doesn't get the full explanation of water or anything simply by visiting its molecular makeup by means of chemistry and physics. One needs other sciences. So likewise, I want to say that cognitive science needs to explain more than simply, well, cognition is simply equal to neuronal activation. One doesn't get the full explanation of experience simply by visiting its neuronal makeup, since there are looping effects that involve body, environment, personal history, other people, social practices, culture. If we're specifically talking about, you know, particular types of experience, I think one needs to try to bring all of these things into play. So a non-reductionistic cognitive science is one that includes multiple sciences and multiple methodologies. So this is not a new idea. Owen Flanagan, for example, quite a while ago, talked about kind of triangulation, using different methods to get at the phenomenon that one is trying to understand, like cognition or consciousness. But maybe it's more like a polygonation rather than triangulation, where many different multiple perspectives are needed to get to the rich phenomenon that you're trying to explain. So here, I think the real question is, how do you translate this idea into the right kind of methodology? And I think this project is meant to be something like one model of how you might be able to do it, where it's not just looking at what's going on in the brain, but we're taking first-person experience seriously, but we're also looking at certain cultural factors that might play into what's going on, and we're paying attention to the very specific things that are happening in the environment. So to the extent that you can find an experimental way to bring all these things together, I think you get a much richer account. Not that, however, that we did a perfect job here, but in some way it sort of shows the possibility of doing something like this. Thank you very much. And if you're interested in a paper, if you have a smartphone, you can aim at that. Or theoretically.
Thank you very much, Shaun. We now have three commentaries, beginning with Rob Rupert, and then Hugh and myself.
All right, there's a handout. I'm going to try to group through this and get through it in my 10 minutes. I should say, as I start, that I had some of Shaun's material before the talk, and I picked that stuff. I especially want to talk about, may not be all that close related to much of what Shaun talked about, but I hope it will be of interest nonetheless. Let me talk about Bracken, first-person perspective, comments on Gallagher, and on neurophenomenology in particular, because that's part of what I'm kind of struggling with, trying to figure out the methodological import of some of these claims about first-person reports, first-person experience. So how are cognitive science and phenomenology connected? Here's a quick argument. Cognitive science is a third-person scientific enterprise. Subjective experience is an essentially first-person phenomenon. Okay, subjective experience plays no role in cognitive science, right? So I think this is supposed to reflect a certain kind of hard-nosed attitude that some people see as dominating cognitive science maybe in the 50s and 60s and 70s. Now, I'll argue that subjective experience of a scientifically relevant sort isn't an essentially first-person phenomenon. That's the way I'll sort of try to solve, relieve the tension, and get something like first-person experience into cognitive science. But there's this neurophenomenological alternative, which I think is closer to the sort of thing that Professor Gallagher wants to do, right? That subjective experiences are themselves data to be explained. You saw a fair amount of this coming up in Shaun's discussion of the last couple of slides, where he was talking about sort of consciousness as something that cognitive science is accounted for, or cognition as something that cognitive science is accounted for. It's sort of like, you know, it's part of the data that's given. It can't be sort of sent away as non-germane, not properly part of the science. Perhaps, but explananda must have a public character if they're to be the subject of scientific investigation. And part one way of thinking about this is the following way. Cognitive scientists don't actually set out to explain cognition or explain consciousness. Cognition and consciousness are theoretical entities or theoretical kinds that are proposed in order to account for data. What scientists do is model data. And so the question is, what's given as data? Lots of measures have been used in connection with subjective experience. So you get things like verbal report, most commonly used one, nonverbal behavioral measures like pushing buttons, maybe doing so in a flexible way. One particular kind of flexibility involves responsiveness to changing instructions. If subjects are able to, you know, reverse the categorizations they've been making immediately when the experimenter tells them to, then the assumption is that the process of making those categorizations was a conscious process. You get things like inverse correlation between subject confidence and error rates. I include some of these things to show the degree of, the number of different kinds of measures that have been used. Now in the cognitive neuroscientific age, we get activity in frontal parietal circuits, we get strength of activity in sensory areas, and there are probably some I've left out. So all these things have been sort of used. Data collection tools, they're thought to have something to do with first-person experience. I want to know how first-person experience fits into this. Do we get phenomenology as a kind of neuroscience? Or is phenomenology going to make a contribution to neuroscience over and above these standard kinds of measures like verbal report? So let's, you know, work through this possibility. Subjects can be trained to make verbal reports that correlate statistically with neural states that they produce those reports. I put produce in scare quotes only because lots of other things may be contributing to, you know, causally to the production of those reports. I don't want to sort of bias that. Cultural history, family background, all kinds of things got you to the situation where you are now. But right now, right, you're giving a report and it carries information about the kind of state that produced it. Differences between the report states carry information about differences between the production states. There are other behavioral measures that can be correlated with verbal reports, things like reaction times, and neural states that distinctively cause those behavioral reports. Right? So let me go through an example very, very quickly, and you'll get a better idea of what I'm on about. In that kind of report study by Varela's group, it's something Shaun refers to in a couple of his papers, I think, subjects reported their degree of readiness prior to exposure to a visual stereogram. So you've got a visual stimulus, it's got these two little boxes, you're supposed to look at it and fuse the boxes. Right? In the initial stimulus, nothing happens when you fuse the boxes. And then, so a different stimulus comes on the screen, and you're supposed to refuse, start again, fuse the boxes, and it's one of those magic eye type stereograms where an image pops out. In this case, it was a rectangle. So significant correlations are found between the reaction times and subjects' verbally provided description types. So there are these phenomenological interviews, the subjects say, yeah, I was steadily ready, I was just ready the whole time, ready for this stuff to happen. And some of them say, well, yeah, I was ready, but I got distracted once in a while. And there are further categories like, I was daydreaming when we were doing at the beginning of the experiment before I saw the first stereogram. So there are correlations here. There are correlations between those description types, those verbally reported description types, and what are taken to be the neural signatures. There are some neural signatures that go along with these that are measured by EEG. I won't talk about the nature of those, but there are kinds of things that are typically associated with attention. There are correlations between those neural signatures and reaction times, and what would probably explain that, a correlation between those neural signatures of the verbal reports and the neural signatures of the states that produce the behavioral reactions. So the kind of neural activity associated with the relevant kind of visual processing. So I've got a verbal report, I've got the kind of attention state that's producing the verbal report, I've got a behavioral reaction, I see the rectangle, And I've got the visual processing that causes me to say, oh, I see the rectangle, that part of the experiment. So what's going on? I've got these four data streams. It appears to be nothing more than the use of correlations between four different data streams to detect causal structure. Reports are caused by neural states which causally interact with other neural states to produce reaction. Those reports, what I mean by that are the phenomenological reports, just the so-called first-person reports, where you ask people what it was like to be getting ready for the stereogram, or what it was like to be sitting there prior to exposure to the stereogram. Just one more stream of data, and what you get from these four streams and the correlations between them is a nice picture about the overall causal reaction between different types of states and different types of behaviors. There's some stuff here about training. I've only got a couple minutes left, so I'm going to skip that. So I want to sort of ask what we get from this sort of scientifically respectable neurophenomenology, and in particular what we don't get from this scientifically respectable neurophenomenology that comes out of this work of Varela and his group, very similar to some of the stuff that Gallagher's doing. We don't get a personal level. We don't get subjective states that are essentially the experiences of persons. There's nothing in that methodology, those experimental results, or those correlations that gives you anything like that. We don't get, verbal reports are correlated with neural states that causally interact with other neural states. Talk of a personal level is gratuitous if that's meant to be anything more than a way of indexing, say, the organism in which these various states are happening. Another thing we don't get from scientifically respectable neurophenomenology, we don't get anti-reductionism. And as I was understanding it, I think from the end of Sean's talk, I realized maybe I'm thinking about this a little differently than Sean is. But the outcome of Lutz et al.'s experiment is a result within the broadly speaking reductionist framework. It could have turned out that regularities in verbal report data don't track anything that correlates with other behavioral data. As a matter of contingent fact, they do. But the usefulness of the verbal report doesn't make anyone in cognitive science say, oh my gosh, there's something going on that I would never, that kind of defies my methodological commitments, right? Verbal reports are produced by some neural states, and whether those neural states correlate with reaction times on other measures is just a sort of contingent fact about the way the cognitive architecture is set up. And so things turning out one way rather than another isn't an anti-reductionist result. The brain's making its standard kind of contribution. And we don't get constrained by intimate and direct knowledge a subject has about his or her experience. This is a quotation from Lutz et al. Lots of the time, Lutz and colleagues talk the way I'm talking, just about four different data streams, but sometimes they quote what sounds like a more sort of robust, theoretically laden interpretation on this stuff. So attention to our experience as such does not constrain the model. The first personness isn't doing any more work than, say, the first personness of a subject's behavior. The former has no distinctive overriding power or authority. There's this long history of, we know that people are bad in lots of circumstances and reporting their motivation states on their cognitive processes. We shouldn't go into this with any supposition that the content of the first-person report tells us about what's going on the inside. But we can find correlations, and this may be very powerful. When an experimenter asks me to do something, my behavior is a response to the content of what the experimenter asks. But you don't then think there's a first-personness about my behavior that's somehow special. I'm saying verbal reports in the same sort of category. The experimenter asked me to do something. There's some words used, that stimulus, I respond by saying, I felt ready before the I saw the random dot stereogram. Better wrap things up. Bracketing theoretical assumptions. One thing that's emphasized in the history of phenomenology is the bracketing of theoretical assumptions and the focus on the phenomena itself, the experience itself. I think what I've been doing in the last few slides is trying to get us to bracket theoretical assumptions. The subjects may be reporting on their phenomenological experience, but let's keep that report as minimal as possible. Phenomenology has a place in cognitive science only when proper bracketing is practiced, that is, only when we bracket the theoretical commitments to the personal level, to some experiences that come between the dynamic neural signatures and the report, that these commitments that seem to create tension between phenomenology and third-person methodology, then we just wind up with better planning, third-person methodology. Thanks.
How it is that we think children develop, how it is that we think children learn, and what it is that we think make people different. different from non-human primates and other animals. And this is important both in terms of cognitive theories and also in terms of social theories as well. Probably the most extreme example of this comes from theories of cognitive development. And this is a tradition that stretches all the way back to Piaget, notions of constructivist theories, how children start to learn about the world, how they start to experience the world. The idea is that children build up their mini scientific theories of the world based on kind of the same experiences of awe and wonder that may be being talked about in the current presentation. So the idea that children suddenly start to learn about, say, conservation of matter, from experimenting on matter themselves, from pushing around matter, interacting with solid objects, it generates some form of wonder, some form of awe. In fact, some of the definitions of awe and wonder that were given here today, slight kind of close to Piaget's ideas about accommodation as well, and assimilation of additional data. This sort of idea, I think, has been put in the most sort of media-friendly way by Alison Gopnik. She talks about explanation as orgasm in the sense that as orgasms drive us to go and procreate, the feeling of explanation is what causes us to go and explore the world, make sense of the world. And at the same time, although this idea of motivation has been, experience motivation has been key for all these theories, we have essentially no work on it. There's no real scientific work on what these experiences are like for children. There's no scientific work that tries to change these experiences in children. We know an awful lot about how children build up their theories in terms of the cognitive processes by which they go and explore the world. We know very, very little about why it is that they go and do different things. This sort of phenomenological work maybe provides some sort of handle here. Same thing, I don't know why that's happening. The same thing is true in attachment theory as well. Lord. Alright, okay. Edinburgh computers aren't working so well. I'll just tell you a little bit about what might be behind that box. And the same thing is true in attachment theory. So, notions of Bowlby's theories of attachment, where we try to explain children's social behavior based on their relationships with their parents. In these cases, parental behavior is always creating some sort of cognitive state. Phenomenological state in young children, which then goes and guides their future behavior. We know an awful lot about the sort of environments and the sort of family processes by which these mental states are put together, but we know much, much less about exactly what it is that children might be experiencing these moments, which is odd because these are the questions that we always get asked about as psychologists. We just never go and study them. And if I could get to the next slide. Excellent. Okay. So this is bad for you guys because this was the point where I was going to start showing you cute videos of children doing funny things. The final part of this is that not just sort of theories of development, but theories of human uniqueness use this notion of experience motivations as part of the core as well. So theories of why it is that culture has emerged, theories of why it is that language has emerged, all rely not only on a specialized set of cognitive tools, but oftentimes on sets of human particular motivations as well. So maybe it's some sort of pleasure in cooperation. It's something that Michael Tomasello was often arguing for. Or maybe some sort of pleasure in teaching or being taught, which is something that Gerhard Gibro was arguing for. All of these things are motivations, mental states that have some sort of characteristic, but we don't really know anything about them. And yet, at the same time, it seems really, really clear that young children experience these mental states because we can see it whenever we look at a young child. So this is a video from a study by Felix Varnikin, who's a really good young cognitive developmental psychologist at Harvard. He studies what children's motivations to help others. And it seems very clear from we just had no real way to go and characterize it. So in this experiment, the experimenter accidentally dropped something, and the question was what the children's response would be. And you can see that this young child is genuinely distressed that the person dropped it. I don't know if you can see that they're too far away. He's clearly experiencing something that is not really relevant to his day-to-day life. You know, the experimenter is off doing something else once he gets to explore his game. But he has some sort of motivation to go and help the experiment. So we just don't know anything about what that is. So in each of these cases, then, there's an assumption that much of human behavior can be explained by some sort of mental state with this distinct phenomenological component, but the nature of these mental states is basically unexplored. And I think that experimental philosophy can really, really help us here. Of course, the big problem is that the sort of phenomenological method that was being talked about today has very little to say about the populations that are of interest here. Young children, babies, non-human primates, other non-human animals, these are not populations that can give us any sort of interview. And if a participant can't explicate their experiences to us, then it's not really clear how we can give this sort of non-reductionist explanation, or at least what I thought to be sort of non-reductionist explanation that was being talked about today. Is there a solution to this? Well, one possibility is to develop a better method for exploring these sorts of subjective experiences. Honestly, I'm not entirely sure what that is, and I'd be interested to try and talk about these things a little bit. And the other is to move to an explanation that's more reductionist in terms of its focus on computational cognitive processes, on neural processes, or environmental causes, and just accept that that's the limit we have to face. Thank you very much.
Thinking about this, and we thought it's really odd that so much experimental philosophy
is based on surveys, and particularly David gets very upset about this because he points out that social psychologists have been telling us for a very long time that questionnaires are a notoriously bad way of getting at what people think. What people say they will do in a situation, when they read a scenario, there's someone about to die, would you throw yourself in front of the train? Well, perhaps you want to impress the experimenter. You say, of course, I would self-sacrifice myself any day, throw myself in front of that stampede of buffaloes. And we know from social psychology that what people say they'll do and what they actually do can be quite different beasts. There's lots of work on the Milgram experiment about this. Describe the Milgram experiment and people will undoubtedly say, of course, I would pull that lever. Put them in the same situation, you get very different behaviors. And of course, social psychology has brought up kinds of things like implicit biases and self-descriptions of rationality, which we know affect our thoughts and affect our behaviors in ways that we're not conscious of. There's also all kinds of framing effects that we get with surveys. So the problem with giving someone a questionnaire is that you can't possibly capture the contextual complexities of the situation. Yet, we know from lots of psychological work that it is those contextual complexities that are so interesting. It's those contextual complexities which adjust our behaviors in ways we can't possibly predict. Whether there's an unpleasant noise going on in the background affects how likely you are to help someone. That seems really unusual, and yet those effects are there. And so that's why I think that philosophy in virtual environments is so important. This is why virtual environments are important for philosophy, because they offer a genuine escape from the armchair. We're not just introducing more armchairs from the mix, we're actually leaving them. The joy of virtual environments is that you can see what people do in situations. We can set up, if you wish, a trolley problem, which doesn't kill any graduate students, which actually puts someone in a virtual environment and see whether they pull that lever. Sure, it's not the same as pushing somebody off into the tracks of that trolley, but we're getting a step away from just reading a vignette. And Natalie Golds has done some really great work on this. It gives people a real situation, well, a closer to real situation, and that in itself will result and spark different cognitive responses and therefore affect the experience. We can get those contextual features. We can see how, if by adjusting the by making small variations in the environment someone's in, that affects their behavior. And this reflects the flexibility that Shaun was talking about that he found very important in virtual environments. And I think this really comes through in Shaun's work that he presented today, the perspectival shift. That perspectival shift of, wow, we're in a tiny planet. It seems that one of the key stimuli for getting that was the change in what you saw. That very experience that you had of sitting in the replication of the NASA central room. In a way that just reading about how small the world is in contrast to the universe doesn't give you that perspectival shift. And I think that's a really nice illustration of something you can get in a virtual environment which you don't get in a survey method. However, the methodologies that we're using, or the methodologies that David and I are thinking about, are still very behavioural. We haven't kind of thought about how to do these sort of phenomenological interviews that Shaun describes. So we're interested in how we attribute consciousness to others. And the very first question we asked ourselves is, how do we operationalise attributions of consciousness? And immediately we started thinking about how we behave towards other things that we think are conscious. And so immediately we're using behavior as our measure. How do people behave in response to other things? And what does that tell us about how they attribute consciousness to that thing? So we haven't gone all the way that Shaun wants us to in terms of cognitive phenomenology, in terms of doing those first-person interviews. But I think virtual environments give us, certainly give philosophers, an opportunity to get out of that survey method by giving us an opportunity to elicit behavior, and that gets us past some of those barriers that survey methods throw up. And the joy of this is that virtual environments are not as inaccessible or as expensive as people think. I realize that the setup Shaun had here was really complex. We're using a piece of equipment called the Oculus Rift, Mark Zuckerberg has just bought the Oculus Rift and says there'll be one in everyone's house within 3 years. So these things are made to be expensive. Thinking about cognitive phenomenology, it clearly offers a complement to behavioral methods. But as Rob pointed out in his commentary, perhaps we're in danger of circulating back to the social psychologist criticism of survey type experimental philosophy, namely what people say they think isn't a good accurate, isn't necessarily an accurate measure of what they do think. And is this the same with experience? So I haven't thought about this very much, but here are some preliminary thoughts that I have had. There's two different explananda here. The first is how people experience the world, getting people to tell you how they experience the world. And if we get the methodology right, we can manage to genuinely tap in through these phenomenological interviews to how people experience the world. It does seem difficult to then challenge someone and say, you're wrong, you're not experiencing the world that way. Contrast this against what people say they think. Now, typically in philosophy, thinking is traditionally construed functionally. So what you think ought to make you behave in certain ways, ought to make you think in, have particular trains of thoughts, causal trains of thoughts. So if you're not exhibiting the right behaviors to match what you say you think, or you're not kind of having the right follow-on thoughts, then an experimenter is legitimately allowed to doubt that you think what you say you think. So perhaps putting this in a more concrete example, you have someone who says, I'm absolutely not a racist, I don't believe in racism, and I know that I myself am not prone to implicit biases. But if that person kind of consistently treats people of a different race differently, in a negative way, that person, you know, as we've seen in experiments, sits further away, chooses not to sit next to a person from a different race. Then the experimenter is legitimate in saying, well, maybe you don't actually think what you say you think. You say that you're not a racist, that you genuinely don't believe that you're affected by implicit biases and racism, race stereotypes, yet we can see from your behavior that really you are, so your testimony isn't a very good insight to what's going on there. And I think that that is a this makes the social psychologist criticism of experimental philosophy perfectly legitimate. Because if in experimental philosophy you're trying to find out what people think, and you just do that by asking them, then because your experimentum is what people are thinking, you need to look beyond what they tell you. You need to look beyond testimony and look to behaviors and other things. But perhaps the explanandum of cognitive phenomenology is slightly different, because it's not amenable to functional analysis in quite the same way. Amenable to functional analysis in quite such an obvious way. It's not clear what kind of experience, what kind of behaviors, what kind of trains of thoughts we should expect someone to have from a particular experience. So there seems to be a slight disanalogy there. And perhaps there is an important role for the kind of trained observer analysis that Shaun proposes to really get a good description of how people experience the world. So two brief conclusions. First, increasing awareness of the importance of putting people in a situation. So we just don't know enough. Social psychologists are doing more, but we don't know enough about how contextual factors affect people's experiences. Virtual reality offers a perfect example, a perfect way to tap into that. And secondly, when it comes to neurophenomenology, I think that I agree with Shaun that it's vitally important that we acknowledge how people experience the world as a valid explanandum. Precisely so that we can then understand what it is that we're trying to explain. And because of that, there's a really important role to be done by these trained observer interviews. And I'd like to finish with a quote from Winnie Pooh, which I, to my undergraduates, when we start the philosophy of mind course. It goes like this. Hello, said Piglet. What are you doing?
Hunting, said Pooh.
Hunting what?
Tracking something, said Winnie the Pooh, very mysteriously.
Tracking what? Said Piglet, coming closer.
It's just what I ask myself. I ask myself, what?
What do you think you'll answer?
But you'll have to wait until I catch up with it, said Winnie the Pooh. And that, to me, characterizes how philosophers perceive consciousness. We have to wait until we catch up with it. And what Shaun has offered, I think, in this paper, is a way of trying to characterize that woozle. So Willie Hu is looking for a woozle. And I think that consciousness is the philosopher's woozle. We still don't quite know what it is that we're looking for. And this trained observer of interpretation and trying to prioritize first experiences, first-person experiences, can begin to give us some handle on that woozle.